This week on Fireside Chat, we discuss Kari Ramo's three consecutive starts and how he looked during those games, which Flames veterans have impressed us, both for better and for worse this year, as well as the Jarome Iginla homecoming, recent roster moves, looking ahead at this week's games, and more. This is Fireside Chat, episode 32, Iginla's homecoming, recorded December 9th, 2013.
Are you ready? See you red. It's time for another episode of Fireside Chat, featuring Dan, Matt, and Lucas.
Welcome back to another snowy night here in Calgary and another episode of Fireside Chat. This week it's just Matt and I. How you doing, Matt?
Very good, as always.
And we're coming off a week with three Flames games, and this was a week that we didn't think the Flames were going to do all that well when we talked last week. We thought they might be lucky to squeak out with 2 points, and they ended up winning both the game against the Coyotes and the game against the Oilers. And they lost, unfortunately, the game against the Avalanche. What'd you think of the past week and the Flames' performance?
Well, they've returned to their beginning of the season ways of being a hard-working team and, you know, just giving the other team what for. And, you know, they're looking a lot more cohesive from the first line through the fourth.
Yeah, I was at the Coyotes game, and when I watched that team, you're right, they looked like a hardworking team. They looked like they were all in sync, which is something I think we haven't seen in a while. And the whole roster, everybody looked like they knew their roles, they knew what they had to do, and they went out there and they won the game. And I really didn't think, I mean, Phoenix scored first, Calgary scored. I really didn't think after that, going into the second with a 1-1 tie, that the Flames were going to end up getting three more goals and winning the thing. I think as with such a big lead, not just in goals, but I think they really outplayed the Coyotes in that one.
Yeah. I was actually quite surprised with how poorly Grice for Phoenix played in net. Yeah, like each of the four goals that he gave up seemed that, like if it was Mike Smith in net, that, you know, we might have lost 1-0. So, you know, it's just one of those things.
Well, I think that's an advantage you have as a rebuilding team, is the teams tend to underestimate you and put their backup in and that sort of thing. So I think it's a positive for the Flames that often teams are going to come in and play another goalie who, yeah, maybe we do have a better chance against. But yeah, I agree. He didn't look good in that game at all.
No. It's good that the Flames were able to take advantage of the weaker performance by the other team instead of making their backup look like an all-star, like, you know, has been RMO for the last decade.
And speaking of goalies in that game, I think we do have to give props, though, to Kari Ramo. He's played three games he had three consecutive starts, and he played in four games in a row. He came in at the end of the Anaheim game, and then he played the three after that. So he played Phoenix, Colorado, LA. And I thought the Ramos looked very good in those games. I think this is the first time, correct me if I'm wrong, this is the first time he's been in net really since Barra's come up, besides relieving Barra. This is his first start. And I think that he played like a guy who had a lot to prove. I think he realizes that starting goaltender spot's on the line. He probably thought with Joey McDonald here that, you know, that spot was his, and now it looks like a man who's got something to prove. What did you think of his play this last week?
Well, having a open starting position on the Flames, you know, you're going to get, you know, if you become a starter in the NHL, you're going to obviously earn a better paycheck and all that. So, in addition to, you know, wanting to be the guy. So, you know, like, it's not really unexpected that, you know, he'd be trying to put his best foot forward to try and wrestle that spot back now that he got an opportunity. You know, what matters is seeing, like, how he plays this week or next week. You know, like, does he start regressing back to his beginning of the season form, or is this the new paradigm? Who knows? Like, Barra against Edmonton, he had a decent, albeit unspectacular, effort. So, yeah, like, he's right there as well. So, you know.
You know, I wonder if perhaps Ramo's problem at the beginning of the season was that there was nobody to push him. I mean, I don't know that Joey McDonald was ever really pushing him for that starter spot. And maybe now that Barra's there, he feels like he has to really keep his game elevated and play hard every night, knowing that if he doesn't, someone else is going to take that job.
Yeah, and looking ahead, like, if Ramo doesn't win the starting position here, he's not likely ever going to be a starter in the NHL, so, yeah, like, he's also looking at it from that perspective, where Barra, you know, he hasn't really had much of an opportunity, so he's still got some rope left beyond this year. So, you know, it's like hit Ramo's last stand.
Yeah, we've never really talked about it that way, but I think that's a good way to look at it. This is really Barra's first crack, and we're happy with what we see. But if it doesn't work out, or if we need to, you know, make a move there in the goalie department, not necessarily a trade, but just send Barra down to the AHL or whatever, we have some goalie depth right now. And yeah, I think you're right. This is. I mean, Ramo's had a shot before. The Flames acquired him, and we're really looking forward to bringing him in. You could tell because Feaster would always talk about how excited he was to get Ramo over. And, yeah, I think this probably is Ramo's last shot, and you're probably right. He's probably realizing that if he doesn't make the best of this now, he may never play in the NHL again, be it as a starter or a backup. I don't think anyone's going to pay the money that we're paying him right now to be a backup and absorb that contract from us. I think that if it doesn't work out, there's a lot of other guys who people would keep on as a backup even over him.
Yeah, and especially with the contracts that are available in the KHL for someone like Ramo. Yeah, if he doesn't pan out as a starter here, then, yeah, financially it would almost make more sense to be over there. So, yeah, it all depends, but, you know.
Yeah, I mean, if he can make starter money in the AHL, why stay over here as a backup or even as a, you know, or sorry, in the KHL, if he can make more money there, why stay here as an AHL starter and an NHL backup?
Yeah, exactly. Like, you know, realistically, at the end of the day, if you're going to get paid $3 million plus overseas versus $700,000, you know, which would you rather take, you know? So, gotta weigh that as well.
Yeah, I mean, he's got a fairly big contract right now. Ramo's on $2.75 million for this year and next year. So that's probably about the kind of money he'd make in the KHL. And that's probably why the Flames are paying him that, because they had to be competitive to get him over here. And his actual hit is 2.7 as well. So there's no two-way on that. That's a one-way deal. So, yeah, I think, you know, the Flames can afford to keep him around this year, no matter how good he is. We can probably afford to keep him around next year, especially if the cap goes up, which they're talking about. And then after that, it'll be definitely time to see if it's Barra or somebody else.
Yeah. Well, the thing is that the Flames only have $35 million committed next year, and that includes Ramo. So, like, you know,
we're going to have to spend. So if they get rid of him, they'd have to bring in another overpriced goalie.
Yeah, like, we're already going to need to spend around $15 million just to hit the floor, so, you know, and we don't have that many spots to fill, so.
I mean, coming into the season, before seeing Barra really excel like he has, I was a Ramo fan. I thought Ramo was the guy. He was probably not the, you know, the guy for the long term, but he was the guy for right now. I thought he's probably the guy who the Flames could ride for a couple of years. And so I'm glad to see that he's looking good again. He's starting to, you know, play like a guy who wants an NHL spot.
No, most definitely. You know, it's always good to have a goalie competition because you just never know when somebody's just going to find their right mode as a goalie. Like, sometimes it never happens, but, you know, like, each of them is talented. Like, they wouldn't be there if they weren't. It's just, they gotta figure out to mitigate the weaknesses in each of their games in order to, you know, become that reliable, dependable guy that you can actually throw out there and, you know, most times he'll give you a chance to win.
Yeah. And, you know, I've said this before, but I think we have to be careful because we're used to having Kiprusoff, who, you know, did look great, did give us tons of chances to win, probably more than we ever deserved. And so I think that we have to remember who we have in net and that the situation has changed.
Yeah, it's a lot more like the Rick Tabarachi, Ken Riggett days than, you know, the Kipper days.
The good old days, I remember those.
Yeah, painful memories.
Yeah, and, you know, I mean, not every team, especially going through a rebuild, can have a Mika Kiprusoff. I mean, we may have to go with a, you know, 1A, 1B, whatever that is that looks like for a couple of years, until we find the guy. And as we've said with all the other positions on this team, the more guys we can try out, the more sure we'll be that we have the right guy.
Yeah, and if you look around the league, it's not like it's overly difficult to find a decent goalie. Like, Toronto and Tampa both filled their long-term positions, you know, like, for relatively cheap as well. So, you know, it's not that big of a deal. Like, if you fast forward a year or two, you might be able to get someone from Anaheim, because, like, they have Gibson, Anderson, Fast, and Hiller that all look really good, so...
Yeah, and we've talked in the past about how we think Hiller would be a good goaltender for this team. Well, moving on from the goalies, I guess staying on kind of the same topic as Kari Ramo, we spent a lot of time this year focusing on the rookies on the team and the good that we've seen from them. Last week we talked about Berchi and perhaps what we're not seeing from them that we'd like to see from them. But I thought it might be a good idea to focus on some of the veterans. I mean, you know, we've kind of had the discussion over the weeks of these veterans really in the end are all replaceable. Any one of them is just a piece that can be swapped in or out. But who do you think is the veterans have surprised you this year, positively and negatively? I mean, they are a part of this team, and as much as, yeah, they might not be here next year, let's talk about what they're doing right now. Who's surprised you positively this year for the veterans, Matt?
The three veterans that have impressed me the most with their play this season are, of course, Yuri Hudler. Yeah, like, this is probably his breakout season. And his offensive contributions are kind of plainly evident for anyone to see. But I've also been really impressed with the play of both Matt Stajan and Brian McGrattan. You know.
Really, grats.
Like, I've seen a lot in McGrattan's game. He's actually looking like a credible fourth line player, not just, you know, your rent-a-fighter. So, you know, like, that's... Plus, his personality rubs off on the rest of the team, and, you know, it looks like when he's out there playing, the rest of the team looks 2 inches taller, so...
And obviously management probably thought the same thing as you, because we had two tough guys, and they got rid of our other one, which was Tim Jackman. So they're probably thinking the same as you, is this guy's not just our fighter anymore, he could be a credible fourth-line player.
Mm-hmm. And Matt Stajan, to me, he's looked probably the best that he's ever played in the Flames jersey, both in terms of creating scoring opportunities, especially lately, but also his defensive efforts on both the penalty kill and 5-on-5.
Yeah, I think, you know, Stajan's a player that for years as Flames fans, we've all been kind of wondering what was wrong with him. I mean, he came over in the FNUF deal. He probably got a raw deal in that we're expecting a lot more from him coming to that deal. And it took him a couple of years to warm up. And I thought end of last season and this season, he's really, not that he, you know, is anywhere near Dion Phaneuf's level or anything, but he's really started to look like he's finally settling in and coming into his own here in the Flames jersey.
Mm-hmm. Oh, most definitely. He's looked like a credible second, third line center that, you know, any team would be able to throw out there without much issue.
So do you think, and I'm just looking it up here, Stajan's contract, it's got to be coming to an end fairly shortly here.
Yeah, he's done at the end of the year.
So would you re-sign him? Do you think that he's earned himself another spot on this team because of the way that he's played?
It's one of those things that, for how he's playing, he's a valuable piece, but I'd also would rather get the draft pick for him and maybe try and re-sign him in the offseason or sign somebody else that can do his job. You know, like, we really need to not be as concerned with keeping our guys, you know, for the long term, like, especially anybody over the age of 24.
Yeah, I mean, at some point, some veteran's going to have to come in, be it him or somebody else. We have to, I think, replace all these positions with other veteran guys. But I think it's, yeah, I mean, if Stajanel resign, I agree with you. I'd trade him away the deadline if it was me. Get whatever we can get for him. And if we can bring him back in the offseason, great. I probably wouldn't pay $3.5 million for him again unless we absolutely need to stay under cap. But there's a lot of guys that'll be free agents that could fill the same void.
Yeah. And, like, on Calgary Puck, like, this week, I had a discussion about the possibility of maybe acquiring Brad Richards from the Rangers, you know, to kind of replace, basically, part of what Stajan brings and part of what Camilleri brings in terms of offense. But, you know.
And what do you think the asking price for Richards would be?
Well, they're looking at likely buying him out just because his contract is, you know, for another 6 years at 6.67.
Yeah, I mean, when they signed him, we were playing for him at the same time, and I'm really glad, seeing the way he's performed now, that we didn't end up winning that contract.
Yeah, well, the thing is that if you look at how his dollar breakdown of how his contract is structured, like, the next 2 seasons, he gets paid $8.5 million. The season after that, $7 million. But the final 3 are $1 million each. So, you know, like, if you're a team like, say, Florida or Phoenix that is trying to save as much money as possible, like, if you use Richards for the next 3 seasons, then, you know, you could possibly entertain trading him to somewhere like that where they can benefit from using the high cap hit without having to actually pay him that much. You know, there's options.
You know, I was just looking this up because I know how much he was, I know how much they're paying him. And it came into my head, with the new CBA, teams can actually absorb a portion of a player's contract when they trade him. And I'm just looking up the rules here. Teams can retain a percentage of a contract's remaining cap hit, salary, and bonuses in trades. The following stipulations apply. No more than 50% of the salary/cap hit can be retained. Salary/cap hit cannot be retained on more than 3 contracts in 1 season. And the aggregate cap hit cannot exceed 15% of the upper limit. That's 1.5%. A contract can be traded only twice where salary cap is retained. So, knowing that, I mean, that's a new tool, and I don't actually think we've seen anybody use that yet, as far as I know. But, you know, that could allow the Flames to even trade some of our guys that are making a lot of money and offer to pay half of that. You know, hey, maybe somebody wants Stajan to the deadline. They don't have 3.5 against the cap, so we could cover half that. And I totally forgot that was doable now.
Yeah, well, like, if you look at how the season's laid out, like, the trade deadline's after the Olympics, which effectively makes the trade deadline, like, in February, like, the beginning of February, not March. So, but in terms of how you're able to structure your cap space, you know, like, the players all cost more. So, you know, like, if you got an expiring UFA, and say, like, Chicago can only afford, like, say, like, $2 million, you know, and Stajan costs 3.5, well, maybe you eat the percentage of whatever's remaining to make it feasible.
Yeah, exactly. And that's a new tool that I think the Flames of all teams may be able to take advantage of this year.
Well, we gotta stay above the floor somehow.
It's true. So you've told us who you think is doing well this year for the Vets. Who have you not been pleased by? Who's been kind of surprised that they haven't been performing as well as you'd like them to?
Oh, The two main guys would be the guys that we acquired for Tange and Sarich, David Jones and Shane O'Brien. I wasn't really under much illusion of what Shane O'Brien was. You know, he's pretty much been a 6'7" defenseman, and he's proven to be that for us. But I thought with the opportunity, especially with a rebuilding team, that Jones would have been able to step up and, you know, try to earn his paycheck. And, you know, like, at least we're rebuilding where his overly inflated contract is not going to really be a detriment to the team. But, you know, like,
yeah, David Jones is making $4 million a year for the next 3 years.
Yeah, like, you'd wish he'd be performing a little bit better. Like, you know, between him and, say, Lance Boma, I haven't really noticed much, if any, difference. So,
yeah. Yeah, but, I mean, you know, that's, I think, part of the reason the Flames took that contract, too, is we wanted to get rid of Tange, who was probably harder to move, and the deal was we had to take a bad contract back. So.
Oh, yeah, and sometimes
you need to... I didn't expect him to play to a $4 million player level.
No, but, yeah, you'd like to see him do a little better. And believe me, getting rid of Tange for the headaches that would have incurred, you know, it's well worth moving on.
Yeah, for sure. For me, I think my pros and cons for the veterans, my positives and negatives, I really like the way that Hudler's been playing. I think he's emerged as one of our top forwards. I think he's the guy that we expected when we acquired him. I don't know if maybe it was... Trevanka that held him back last year as they were trying to, you know, get Hudler to feed Trevanka and make him look better, but I'm really happy with what I'm seeing this year. I'm happy with what I'm seeing out of TJ Gagliardi as well. I think that for what we gave up to get him, and a guy on a one-year deal, he's doing really well. And I also really like the way that Dennis Wideman's come into his own as a Flame. He is a defenseman that's making $5.25 million a year for the next 4 years, including this year. And I think that he's really come out to be kind of a top two defense for this team, and a guy that I could see keeping here until the end of his contract. I think he's good veteran leadership.
Oh yeah, and I have no arguments on any of your picks.
My negatives, I think that I would like to see more out of Lee Stempniak this year. I was expecting Lee to come out and play a bigger role as a leader and kind of the veteran player. And I agree with you. I wanted Shane O'Brien and David Jones to step up a little bit more. So I think those guys are disappointing as well.
Well, the thing with Stempniak is that he's always been an extremely streaky player. And, like, when he's on, like, when he got traded to Phoenix a couple of years ago, like, he scored 14 goals after the trade deadline. You know, and was probably their best player for the end of the season. And yet, you know, like, the next year he was just there. You know, he's a very perplexing player.
Yeah, but, you know, I was hoping that maybe with a new role on a team... we might be able to get him past some of those issues that he's had in the past, but it looks like we probably won't. And, you know, he's only got this year left. He's making 2.5. I can see the Flames being able to move him at the deadline or before the deadline. I hope they do and get some for him. And there's a lot of guys, just like we said with Stajan, who could fill that role quite nicely.
Yeah. And realistically, in the off season, you can go and find the next Lee Stempniak second, third line guy. Like, say, someone like Devin Setoguchi or something like that, you know.
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned Setoguchi. Get... I've actually thought about Setoguchi as a Flame for a couple of years now. I've thought, you know, I think we all have that list of players that we ever wonder if they'll get traded to our team because then they'd be a good fit here, and Setoguchi's a guy I've always thought, you know what, he could probably make a decent Flame.
Yeah. You know, and, like, that's why, like, I'm not really concerned if we move on from Camilleri, Stempniak, and Stajan, because, you know, like, we do have to hit the cap floor, and, Yeah, like we're $15 million below the floor for next year. So, you know, we got to sign somebody.
Well, yeah. I mean, to me, I think the Flames might be able to do something that I honestly thought they were actually going to do last summer, was bring in kind of an aging veteran like a Sergei Gonchar and overpay him almost just to be the leader, to, you know, be able to put him on a line with somebody like a TJ Brody, a guy who's got legitimate NHL chops, but who you're overpaying to get them to come to Calgary. And maybe if we, you know, need to pay somebody because we are losing all these veterans, maybe they'll do something like that.
Yeah, that's pretty much along the lines of why I thought maybe getting Brad Richards might make sense. Yeah, just somebody to stabilize. It's basically like what Chicago did a few years ago when they signed Brian Campbell when they were terrible. Because, you know, he helped to take pressure off of both Keith and Seabrook, who are still in the whole learning how to be an NHLer phase. So, you know, just, you need some stability. And it always helps if you get people that are winners, you know, or have been there.
Yeah, and I think in our case, it doesn't even have to be Stanley Cup winners. I think even guys that have been in the NHL for a while and had a playoff shot and know what it takes just to be, yeah, a winner in the NHL and can help, you know, bring that attitude to this team, which it seems like Hartley's trying to foster in everybody.
Yeah, exactly. And, like, that's one of the things that Edmonton didn't do when they started their rebuild. Like, it's like they cast off all their veterans and then just threw the kids into the fire. Well, you know, they can't learn the good habits if they don't have proper teachers. So, you know.
And let's be honest, Habby Boulin is not a teacher.
No. Well, really, any goalie is not going to be very instructive for forwards and such. So,
yeah. And, you know, I've used this term before. I don't want the blind leading the blind here. I don't want a bunch of young guys trying to help each other figure out how to play at the NHL level. We do need veterans, whether it's this crop of veterans or some of this crop or none of this crop. We do need some guys who, like you said, have won, but also guys that have just been around for a while. You know, even a guy like McGrattan, who's just been around the league for a while and knows what it takes to be in the NHL.
Well, like, in the offseason, Conroy, he was mentioning about St. Louis when he was playing there, and when the Blues brought in Al MacInnis, and, like, how it changed their organization because he had such a winning demeanor about him, and, like, that professionalism kind of rubbed off on everybody, you know, and, like, he was saying that, like, they're wanting to foster that kind of persona here. And, you know, like, that does make a lot of sense because, you know, if there's a right way to do things, you know, it's better that they learn from people that do those things in that manner.
And yeah, I won't call it a failed experiment yet, but I think that perhaps David Jones and Shane O'Brien might have been guys they hoped would do that. Guys that have been around the NHL for a while, guys that know how this game is running, they were probably hoping those two could help, you know, be those locker room leaders.
Yeah, it depends, but, you know, it's one of those things that the more the better, you know what I mean? Like, I personally don't really care who they bring in as long as it's somebody with, like, the right attitude.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? we're not building a team to win, so it really doesn't matter if we're stocking up on, you know, high-profile players right now.
Exactly.
Well, there's a couple roster moves I wanted to mention to the listeners and see if either of us had thoughts on them. Today, the Flames sent David Smith to the AHL, and Lane McDermott has been called up here. That's the new acquisition, the guy that we essentially got in a roundabout way, you could say, for Tim Jackman. And Lane McDermott will be wearing number 28. So David Smith has gone down. That leaves Chris Breen, who I believe is now healthy, with a full-time roster spot still listed in Calgary. Do you think that now means that Breen is going to get a full-time shot?
Not necessarily. Like, the Flames at the time were carrying 8 defensemen. So, you know, someone had to go.
We still have 8 defensemen.
Oh, we do? Well,
we have Breen, Brody, Butler, Giordano, O'Brien, Russell, Smead, and Weidman. So we were probably carrying nine then, because, well, I think Breen was on the IR. So yeah, it was probably eight with Smith healthy.
Yeah, just too many defenders right now, and plus Abbotsford, they've been running into some injury troubles on the back end. So yeah.
Yeah, I was about to say that. I think it could probably do Abbotsford some good, knowing they're having a good season. But they're also hitting some injury troubles, to have a veteran guy down there to help out with that.
Yeah. And, yeah, you'd like to see Abbotsford keep it up and maybe win the Calder Cup this year. Couldn't hurt.
That'd be really nice. And so Lane McDermott is now listed as a Calgary Flame. He's wearing Robin Regier's old number, number 28. Are you expecting anything exceptional from him? Are you expecting him to last here for a while?
Yeah, actually, back when he was drafted, the year he was drafted, I watched a little bit of him in the OHL, and he reminded me quite a bit of Lance Boma, and you've seen a bit of that, and, you know, like, he's somebody that'll hit, he'll fight, he can play, you know, if you're expecting him to score 15 goals, you're probably, you know, over-expecting. But, you know, somebody that's just a solid fourth line agitator, pain in the ass type guy, that's what he brings. And realistically, good teams need that kind of attitude. Like, if you remember with Chicago, they had guys like Brouwer, Bollig, you know, like just Burrish.
I think even on their team, Bufflin was sort of playing that role too.
Yeah, just guys that would really drive the opposition up the wall. You know, because anytime you can get the other team off their game where they're reacting to you, you know, it makes them make more mistakes, which leads to goals against. So it's all good. You know, you need, like, each position, like, even though the guy's a fourth liner per se, you know, his role is to get the other team off their game. So, you know, like, it's just as important as Monahan being the goal scorer. You know, every position is equally important. So, you know, having really good third and fourth line guys that can, you know, help to change the tide of a game if it's not going your way, that definitely helps. And McDermott,
and especially guys like you said about McGrattan, guys who aren't just, you know, fighters or bruisers, guys that can actually play, you know, a little bit of hockey on that fourth line as well.
Yeah, and like McDermott's 6'3", so it's not like he's gonna get pushed around much. So, you know, like, we need to have some intimidation moving forward. So
with McDermott and Paul Byron's also up, that gives us 17 forwards. So, to slot McDermott into the lineup, who do you take out? Lance Boma?
That's really tough. You know, there's so many injuries right now that he could, you know, because, like, McGrattan's out with an injury. So, you know, like, after the trade deadline, I think things get a little clearer where, like,
Is McGrattan hurt? He's not listed on the site as injured. He's in the expected lineup for tomorrow night.
Yeah, it was just a minor thing.
Okay.
I think
You just slot him into Gratt's spot for tomorrow night against the Bruins?
If McGrattan's going to play, then let him play. But, you know, you might see someone else, like, say, Blair Jones get pulled and McDermott thrown in.
If it was me, I'd leave Blair Jones in there and I'd probably pull Paul Byron.
Yeah, true.
Byron's had a shot. We know what we've got. Let's put McDermott in and see what he can do.
Yeah, well, especially with a feisty team like Boston, you know, the more guys that, you know, can rough it up a bit, you know, the better, because that's definitely how Boston plays.
Yeah, for sure. I think you need some more sandpaper on the ice with those guys. Yeah,
and I don't really think Paul Byron's going to do much intimidating.
No, he's not. 5'7", he's not going to intimidate anybody. Speaking of Boston, this is the first time that Jarome Iginla returns home since leaving Calgary last year at the trade deadline. I've seen a lot of fanfare in the newspaper, online, talking to Flames fans. I thought we'd spend some time getting each of our thoughts on Jarome. If you don't mind, I'll give mine first. I've been, as you guys probably remember from last year, I've been a Jarome fan for a long time. I mean, you know, I was a kid growing up in Calgary as a Flames fan. I was a longtime Jarome fan, and I guess I realized in the back of my mind that he was not the player he used to be and that we needed to get rid of him. By the time, I didn't want him to go, and I think, you know, looking back, I was one of those guys that said, maybe he'll re-sign here in the offseason, maybe he'll come back, just because I didn't want to see that post-Iginla era in Calgary. But now that we've seen it, I think it was a healthy thing for this team to get rid of him, and I personally don't hold any grudges. I think it was Jarome's time to move on, it was time for the organization to turn over a new leaf. I'm happy to see him come back. I'm glad to see this city's welcomed him back with such open arms, and there's no hostility from what I'm seeing. And I really hope that you know, we can stay on good terms with Jarome, even as he's playing in Boston or wherever he might play, because I still one day want him to be a part of the Flames organization again, be that as head of the alumni committee or raising number 12. I'm just glad that people have kind of put the water under the bridge and we can move on and realize that, yeah, Jarome really helped us out, but we don't need him anymore going forward.
Yeah. It's really hard to add on to, like, all that has been said about Jarome. He was the guy.
He was. Yeah, no question. He was the face of this franchise both on the ice and off the ice.
Yeah, and, you know, like, it's always going to be weird to see him wearing a different jersey, but, you know, like, as you said, it was good for the Flames and him to each go in their own direction, and, you know, like, if Iginla wins a cup in the next couple of years, I'll be extremely happy for him. But, you know, like, we need to, as Flames fans, need to worry about, like, how the Flames move on from here, and, like, how they emerge in the next handful of years. And, you know, when Iginla comes to town, give him all the cheers that he deserves, and, you know.
And I think it's good that he's getting kind of the kudos and the warm welcome he is, because I think it, like you said, he was the guy here, and Flames fans aren't forgetting that. I think we're all still really appreciative of what he's done for this team.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, like, even fans that might not necessarily have been fans of him, they'll still acknowledge, like, that he was the guy, and, like, he had such a positive impact on both the city and the team. So, you know, it's all good, you know.
Yeah, I mean, we spent many episodes last season talking about Jarome and our thoughts, and now I'm looking back at it with a clear head many months later. I really think the Flames did what was necessary. I think it was a win-win for both parties. And like you said, I hope Jarome, for his sake, wins a cup in the next couple of years before he retires. You know, I'm still a Jarome Iginla fan. No matter what colors he's wearing, I'm always going to be a Jarome Iginla fan. I think being a Flames fan through this era, you have to be a Jarome Iginla fan. Or at least cheer for him to get his cup and to do with his career what he couldn't get done here.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, like, even, like, if we kept him in that, like, it would just be delaying the inevitable. And, you know, like, it's like a marriage where, like, each person has moved on, but, like, they're still married, you know what I mean? And, like, you know, it was time to go our separate ways and focus on, you know, each individual party's goals and, you know, still be friends afterwards.
And not only that, but I think both parties wanted to make sure that each other were taken care of. You know, I mean, I think Jarome wanted to make sure he was going somewhere, and we could argue this point, but Jarome was going somewhere that he could do good for him, but he also wanted to make sure he was going somewhere that Calgary could get something back for him.
Oh, yeah, and we did. You know, like, you know, Hanowski looks to be more or less David Moss. Agostino, he looks like a feisty third, fourth line type, and Klenchuk looks like he has top six upside. So, you know, like, we did get something for him. And, you know, each party won from that trade, so...
Yeah, it was a win all the way around. I think the Flames won as well, you know, outside of the players you mentioned. The Flames won just by ending that era and kind of putting that final stamp on, yes, we're rebuilding. See, we're actually serious about it.
Yeah.
It and, gave the Flames, I think, that closure they needed.
Yeah, and plus it helps to remove expectations and disappointment. Like, especially, like, 4 years going... of, like, expecting to win and make it into the playoffs and, you know, every year getting disappointed. It, you know, like, at least this year, like, there's no illusions about, you know, being a playoff contender or anything. It's more just trying to pick out the positives during the year and...
Yeah, I kind of looked at it, too, as kind of a ceremonial... changing of eras as well. Like Jarome again, like you said, was the guy here for a long time, and moving him symbolized that end of the era. This is the end of the Jarome Iginla era, like you said, the years of thinking we had the team and falling short every year and fans being disappointed, and finally the team saying, look, we're closing the book on that. Now we're starting a new chapter.
Yeah. And, you know, like, I wish him all the best, and I'm going to be participating and giving him a rousing ovation on Tuesday. So, you know, I'm glad to hear that. I hope everybody else is, and, you know.
Yeah, I hope he doesn't get booed. I hope that...
I would be shocked to see him getting booed. Like, there's absolutely no reason why he would.
No. No, I don't think so. Well, this is probably going to be our second last show of 2013. We'll do next week, which is the week of the 16th. And then we're going to take some time off for the holiday season so we can all spend some time with our families and friends. And we have some... It's weird to think that when we come back in the new year, it'll be just about a year since we started the show. We didn't have hockey this time last year, and we started the show just after lockout in January. And we've talked as a group, and we have some interesting ideas for next year. Some new content that we want to put into our show. Not just talking about the current Flames product on the ice, but kind of talking about everything that is the Calgary Flames. We want to focus on some Flames that have been, some past Flames, maybe what they're doing now. We want to look at prospects and who we can, you know, start to familiarize fans with who we might see over the coming years becoming a Flame. And just talking about things that, you know, relate to the Flames that aren't directly on the ice this year. And I think, I don't know about you, Matt, but I'm excited about these changes. I think that it's going to be a good change for the show, bring some more interest back. And we're not going to finalize exactly what's going to be done yet, but we encourage everybody to listen next week and then listen again in the new year. And, you know, let us know what you think of the new content that's coming out.
Yeah, you know, like... How would you say, like, with the current iteration of the Flames, you know, the themes are a little bit repetitive, so...
Yeah, we're talking about the same thing week after week, and I mean, we came into this show even, and let's be honest with people, we didn't know what to talk about. You know, we sat here wondering, what do we talk about? We're running out of stuff, unless we repeat ourselves about the goalie challenges and how good the rookies are and that sort of thing.
Yeah, and, you know, like, it gets a little stale for the listener, so, you know, like, with reviewing, like, the Where Are They Now segments, like, we'll be delving into past players and, like, what are they up to now? Did they go into, like, coaching, or, you know, are they starting up a real estate business, this, that, whatever. So, you know, just something interesting to see what, you know,
Flames. Yeah, we've also talked about our opinions on, you know, our favorite Flames of the past and perhaps our least favorite Flames. And there's been a lot of guys, just like any NHL team, that have worn the Flaming C over the years. And I think it would be interesting for the fans to get to know a little bit more about us and, you know, who has shaped our experiences as Flames fans.
Oh, yeah, most definitely. And also having a look at like who's coming up, not many people know about, say, Tim Harrison or Eric Waugh or John Gilmore. So, profiling some of the lesser known names in addition to the guys like Poirier and Gaudreau,
Yeah, the lesser known names who we are expecting that it's important you know because we think these are guys you're going to see in the Flames jersey within the next 3 or 4 years.
Yeah, exactly. Somebody that we think has NHL potential.
So that way,
So.
when you see them on the ice, you can go back and say, I remember when Dan and Matt and Luke were profiling this guy, and I know something about this guy. You can
Yeah.
impress your friends by telling them you know who this kid is.
Exactly. And, it just lots of little segments to help, be informative and, do something a little more interesting than just repeating ourselves about, oh, what's Sven up to this week? So, it's all good.
So look for that kind of revised show in the new year. And as always, let us know if there's something you want to see or hear, if there's somebody you want us to talk about, or if you don't like the stuff that we're adding to the show. Let us know that through social media, through our website. We want to hear from you guys. We do this for you guys. And if you don't like what we're putting out, then we don't want to keep doing it.
Yeah, exactly. Because we're very moldable. If, there's someone that you want us to talk about,
I mean,
we're totally
if the
game.
people don't like what we're talking about, it's easy for us to just sit at home, have beers, and talk hockey on our own. We're doing this because people want to listen to us. So yeah, tell us who you want to hear about. Tell us, who your favorite Flames are.
Yeah.
Interact with us as we're going forward and let us know if this is the show you want or not.
Yeah, exactly. And, if there's a cool idea you have for a segment, we're definitely open.
Well, with that, why don't we wrap this week up? Look at the week ahead. This week we have 3 games, 2 of them home games. Tuesday night we take on Jarome Iginla and the Bruins. Thursday night the Flames take on the Carolina Hurricanes. And Saturday the Flames take on the Buffalo Sabres on the road. 6 points on the table, Matt. How many do you think we can leave with?
I'm gonna go with 4 just because both Carolina and Buffalo are really terrible, terrible teams that even make Edmonton look good.
Buffalo's an awful team this year.
Yeah, Carolina's not any better. Like, they have name players, but man, are they bad.
I think the Flames are going to get out of this week with 5 points. I think they're going to win against the Hurricanes, win against the Sabres, and I think they're going to pull out an overtime loss or shootout loss to the Bruins. I just think that with the momentum that they're going to have going into that game, I think we're going to see the team rise to the occasion. Not be able to beat the Bruins, but at least be able to take them to a shootout.
Oh, you never know. It depends on how much they wanna, get payback for Iginla,
And it's weird. I'm looking at the schedule here. We actually play the Bruins this Tuesday and then the following Tuesday. So we play them twice in a week, once here and once in their barn. So if the Bruins end up taking us this week, maybe we can get them next week.
Either game will be very interesting to watch.
Yeah, I think if you have to pick one game to watch this week as a Flames fan, watch the Bruins game on Tuesday. I think that's the one to watch. All right, well, Matt, where can people find you online?
On Twitter at Caged Great, I'm now up to 54 Twitter followers now, so
Nice. You're doing good. And
yeah.
Matt does great commentary during the away games.
Yep.
And if you want some commentary during the home games or to chat about the Flames in general, you can follow us on Twitter. We're at Fireside Podcast, and we're always interacting with people. We have a bit of a Ramo army going who's been talking to us, quite impressed that Kari Ramo's been getting the starts and looking as good as he is. We post the shows there, so if you're a Twitter user and you want to know when a new episode comes out, follow us on Twitter and you'll see all the new shows. If you're a Facebook user, you can find us on Facebook at www.facebook.com/firesidechat. Again, we post commentary, we post discussion, and we post the show there. Make sure you're visiting us on our website, which is firesidechat.ca, which is where we post all the shows. We got some great articles and commentary there. You can subscribe to our show. And we're also available wherever fine podcasts are. So we're on iTunes, we're on Stitcher. You can grab our feed off our website and put into any podcast aggregator you use, GPod or Dogcatcher or anything you might use on Android or iOS. And yeah, you know, listen to us, subscribe to us. So you get us automatically every week, so you don't need to go find us. And we will see you guys next week for probably our last episode of 2013.
We are the boys in chorus, we hope you like our show. We know you're rooting for us, but now we have to go.
Fireside Chat Podcast, produced and edited by Dan Stevenson.